You're just doing take two because of audio issues, which we had a while back. Oh, here we go. Okay, we're back. Yay! I want to apologize to everybody who came on. It's like, yes, I want to hear about our heart's desires. And there was no audio. And God is not like that. He has audio. But it would help me if someone would just confirm that you are getting audio and video. So I will wait until I get some feedback here. And meanwhile, smile and act like this is normal. technology is awesome when it works, right? So let me just confirm somebody that we are getting audio. Yeah. Confirm that we are getting audio. Okay. All right. Let's see here. So, oh, sounds good. Thank you, Randolyn. Good morning, Katrina. Woohoo. Okay. I think we have liftoff. And whoever Facebook user says you hear me with a smiley face, you know, I wish I could get all my channels and see who's talking to me. But anyway, welcome. And I'm so happy you're here. We're going to have fun today. Oh my goodness. Who is ready to sign up for some fun and some refreshing? How has your week been? If your week has been some kind of crazy, this is all about refreshing and getting recentered and regrounded. A lot of with the stuff that you already know. But how many of you, not just what you know already, is what you're actually encountering and experiencing in a fresh way? How many of you need to be refreshed? I vote for that. So I was talking to the Lord last night, and he was actually just ministering to me some sweet things. There were just some desires of my heart, simple ones. Yay! Thank you, honey. Everybody say hello to Brian. He's on. He's my sweetheart. So of 25 years. Woohoo. So thank you, honey. Good audio, good video. But he was just ministering to my heart about some simple desires that I had and how he made this possible for me. And, you know, and just in that relational way, that who God is, right? God is so relational. He's so easy to please. He's so, you know, he's not touchy. There's no walking on eggshells. As a matter of fact, he just clears all the eggshells out of the way and lets you stomp around and do whatever you do. Cause he is not easy offended. And you know, that's what love is, right? Love is not touchy. And people are kind of touchy. How many of you have run into a couple touchy people recently? How many of you have been one of the touchy people? I've had some touchiness going on with Catherine Toon. And when I get touchy, I usually just kind of isolate myself for a little bit and have some Jesus time until I can be fun to be around. Because I don't need to add to the stress of people's lives. But, you know, we get touchy when we're stressed, when we're fearful. And there's so much pressure going on. And so God gets to be our pressure relief valve. You know, the pressure builds up. Because there's something that, some burden that we're carrying, right? And there's fear that we're operating in. And so the pressure just builds up and builds up. And then we forget, remember the weakness of our frame, we forget that we are already linked in with God, we're already hooked up with God, and that he gets to take the heavy lifting. For those of you who read my Mark My Love book, I have all this stuff on turfing the heavy stuff to Jesus, the ugly stuff to Jesus, the toxic stuff to Jesus, and whatever you are called to carry it, carrying it lightly because you're yoked in with the person of Jesus, that Jesus gets to do the heavy lifting. That is why he came. You know, God didn't have this need before the foundation of the world because he was bored to create the human race. The human race was created because of Son and Holy Spirit being love, exploded in a race of children that look just like himself, that look just like love and are called to love and find our greatest fulfillment in loving one another. Thank you, Randall. You're always so sweet. Oh my goodness. I so appreciate all these people that hang in with me. How many people have had a couple people that haven't hung in with you and And that's okay. You know, sometimes people just have different assignments and go their own way and just get busy. And sometimes people get offended and drop off the planet and whatever that is, drop off your planet. So I'm just grateful for just the lovely people that I get a chance to connect with and do life with, even if it is at a distance, right? Because we are all experiencing so much of the same things. You know, humanity has more in common with one another than we have just in not in common. Yeah. So, okay. That was just all intro. We're going to talk about our heart's desires. Now, how many of you kind of grew up maybe in a sense that somehow we've got to figure out either how to placate God so that we get what we need and get what we want, or we have to work some sort of system that, you know, we need so that we can get what we need and get what we want. And then, you know, when hard things happen, especially if things have been happening for a long time and you haven't seen answered prayer and all of that, at least in the way that you thought it should look like, that you're just trying to figure out, okay, so what am I doing wrong? And so, you know, and I grew up in the Word of Faith camp, and I so appreciate that, what all those incredible people taught me in terms of the Word, in terms of operating in faith and all of that. The downside of that is we can end up trying to work systems and use our faith and just struggle to make something happen. And we forget that it's all happened in the person of Christ, and we were included in Christ. And with that, we get the inheritance that he shares with his Father. And since everything was created in him and through him and for him, that's a heap whole lot of stuff. So whatever our little do is, that's a godly thing. That's even a desire. You know, that is not going to dim the lights in heaven. And we don't have to wrench God's arm to convince him. You know, I get emails from people. I was ministering someone today, and they had read one of my prophetic words. By the way, if you want regular prophetic words that I'm hearing for the body, I sometimes share them on social media, but a lot of times I just share them with my peeps on my mailing list. Just to, you know, so I like to give a lot of content because we need it, right? And so that's just my joy. So if that would be of wow, I'd love that. You can go to my website and just sign up for that. I'm not going to ding you with a bunch of, basically you'll get regular stuff that is there to feed you, not to try to sell you something. I hate that, right? Don't you hate that? I hate that. I'm not a very good salesperson. I do promote some things, but yeah, whatever. So anyway, so trying to get there from here assumes that we're not already home. Trying to get home, good morning, Clint, assumes that we're not already home. Trying to get to God or get into the throne room. Baby, you're not only smack dab in the middle of the throne room, you're smack dab in Christ on the throne, in the throne room. So a lot of these kind of old-fashioned trying to get there from here sense ways that we've been, and I appreciate the charisma. I appreciate it all. Like, I've learned from it all. I'm grateful from it all. But I recognize one thing is that we're constantly growing. And any place where we are feeling separate from God, or that we need to try to please God, and you know, is just intrinsically, you're starting from the wrong place. You're starting from the wrong place, because God is love, and love loves to give. Love's a giver, and he loves to give. And it wasn't that he, you know, like Father God gave his son, and then he's like, well, because my son went to the cross, quit, you know, complaining and moaning, and be grateful. That's not his attitude. Now, it's a good idea not to moan and groan and complain, okay? So if you find yourself getting into that, you know, check yourself and refocus on things that make you grateful. Just the simple things. Sometimes the simplest things are the most, minister to you the most, right? You know, my daughter, Veronica, right now, is growing a garden. And every day we get the garden report, like what's budded, what was eaten by the squirrels. She's just so happy every time there's a little bit of growth. And it's sweet. She's got a beautiful revelation of gratitude. So she's pretty much happy all the time. So there's a lot that we can learn from people like Veronica who are tracking with this concept of gratitude. But you know what? One of the things that gratitude opens is a space where the blessing that we already are partaking of can manifest in our lives. Right? How many of you, I mentioned, I think on the first go round that the June household had some major issues with air conditioning twice. They had to come out twice this week. And I tell you, I'm not that kind of a rough it girl. I'm tough. You know what I mean? But I don't want to be hot and sweaty. Just no, especially at nighttime. Right. And so, air conditioning is a blessing for humanity. Thank you, Jesus, who downloaded the concept of air conditioning into the human race. And he does that. He gives us all sorts of creative concepts. I'm so grateful. And so there are just so many things that we can be grateful for. And, you know, where I was talking about earlier that God is the grantor of our heart's desires. And I'll give you some scriptural backing just in case that you don't think I'm just trying to make a feel good message. And by the way, if you feel good with the message, run with it. The gospel is a happy gospel, and feeling good is part of what God designed you to feel, right? So if it's making you depressed and condemned and heavy, tune it out, baby, because there is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. Now, there are times when God is serious and he is correcting us because, you know what? We are sons and daughters that are called to look like love. And wherever we're violating love, he will convict us. It's called sin because we're not tracking with who we are and we're hurting ourselves or other people. And he's not okay with that. But he is fabulously okay with you. He is pre-pleased. And, you know, track with the manifestation of our heart's desires, we need to track with who God really is and who we are in him. Because if you feel that somehow your behavior has, just not doing it, I'm not reading my Bible enough, you know what I mean? Or, you know, maybe there's some frank sin going on or whatever that is. Well, if it's about you, you started off with the wrong thing. Because let me say this. When you are focused on Jesus, the author and finisher of faith, who is the person of love, okay, when you're focused on him, you really do get your eyes off yourself. But what we need to remember in that, it's not some sort of religious, I can't think of myself because I'm not important because I'm a worm. Well, that's crap. Okay. No, his eyes are all on you. So you get your eyes on Jesus and his eyes his eyes are, yes, plural, are on you. Right? So you get your mind off of yourself, because when you're self-focused, it is miserable. I have teens in the house. We can attest, and we've all been there. But when we get our eyes on Jesus, okay, he is able to take all that burden, all that worry, all that fear, and he knows the desires of our heart. You know, when he placed humanity in the Garden of Eden, which is the garden of delight or the garden of desire. And I know we get really weird about that because we start to connect it with some sort of twisted desires. And of course there are those, absolutely, but they're holy desires that are good and righteous, and God is all about them. So let's start to unpack some scripture with this. How many of you are still loving the Word of God? Rightly interpreted, right? I love the Word of God. I'm so grateful. And I know, you know, there are lots of people who are like so upset with the errancies in the Word. Yes, the Word is not inerrant because the translators are not inerrant. And the Bible does contradict itself, and you have to make it not contradict itself. You literally have to warp the Word. However, there is, you know, there is 98% baby and maybe 2% bathwater. Okay, so let's not be silly and let's take advantage of what's been given us. Okay, Psalm 37:3-5. I'm reading this in the Passion Translation. It says, keep trusting in the Lord and do what is right in his eyes. I'm going to unpack that for a second, unless you are all of a sudden felt heavy. Fix your heart on the promises of God and you will be secure feasting. Sorry, this made me happy. On his faithfulness, make God the utmost delight and pleasure of your life, and he will provide what you desire the most. Give God the right to direct your life. And as you trust him along the way, you'll find that he pulled it off perfectly. Okay, so let's start to unpack this. Number one, it says keep trusting in the Lord. So what is this? Why would it say keep trusting? Because what tends to happen is when a lot of times when we don't see things panning out the way we really wanted them to pan out in our plan A. Okay, sorry, that was funny. You have to understand, I have a lot of internal humor going on and I won't take time to explain all the time, but yes. So that means we tend to fall out of trust. And then we start to backpedal and start, well, what went wrong? What did I do wrong? Did I not pray enough? But you know, blah, 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 blah. And then we start to put it on ourselves again, and then we get heavy all over again, and that really sucks. Oh, hi, Katrina. I just noticed you're back. Thank you. I'm so glad you're back. And hi, Clint. So keep trusting. So that means, you know what, if it's saying to keep trusting, you mean you have the capacity to do this. And how can you trust in God? Let me just help you with this, because he is trustworthy. You know, he's the only one that that is totally trustworthy. I mean, he is faithful. Fruit of the Spirit, right? So that's the fruit of his Spirit is faithfulness, right? So when we're faithful, he's faithful. When we're faithless, he is faithful still, because he cannot deny himself. That's part of who he is. That's his nature as love. So you can keep trusting even when it's not looking like it's that great. Okay. And it says, and do what is right in his eyes. Okay. So before anybody gets heavy and religious here, before I trigger anybody with that particular, do what is right. So what is right in God's eyes? Let's just review really quick. So we have one commandment. Remember, if you guys have been watching me at all, you know what it is. You're going to nail it. It is the commandment of love. Love one another. A new commandment I give you, says Jesus, the person who is loved, the expressed in the image of the Father. A new commandment I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you. So what is right in God's eye? It's loving ourselves, loving one another, loving him back. See, when love happens, it's good, right? Yes. Oh, you just got taken off for a second. I am so confused, Katrina, with how this works. Okay. I mean, I understand how it works, but no, I don't, right? Technology is just a semi black box, but it's working. So yes. And we're able to connect. So we're doing what is right in his eyes, right? Which is loving one another and loving ourselves, right? And how do we do that? We just get so loved on by God. We allow him to lavish ourselves upside down, one side and down the other, and heal all the places that are hurt. Maybe heal all the places that feel like, well, my trust was violated, or, you know, that you didn't come through for me, Jesus. Those places need to be healed. If we've got those places, and a lot of people do. And that's how we can do what is right. We can just love. And, you know, it's amazing. Love fulfills everything. It does. It just fulfills everything. The love, it, law, and the prophets, right? Oh, there's a big delay on the messages. Well, that I believe. Yes. It says, fix your heart on the promises of God. So what are God's promises? Well, he's got a lot of promises. Number one, he promises that he'd never leave us and never forsake us. So that's a really important one. Why? Because you're one with him. So if you're one with the one who loves you, who always loves you, who never decides to love you less, who just is constant in his delight and love and regard for you, and you're tracking with that, well, you know, if your faith, which is his faith, starts to work. Faith works by love, right? And so you can stand, well, one way or the other, it's going to be good. One way or the other, I can rest, and he's going to bring the things that he's told me personally and told generally us as human beings. He will bring them to pass, right? He will do that. Why? Because he's God and he's love and he loves you. And fix your heart on the promises of God. So we got to be careful where we're fixing our heart on. And sometimes what happens is we fix our heart on people. Now, we are called to love one another. But where you fix your heart is where your source is. So we don't make people our source. When people start to make me their source, I can feel it. I feel this weight coming on. Oh, baby, I backpedal. I'm like, no, I'm not your source. Not going to happen. Just look, we're going to look to Jesus. That will help no one. And not me who's carrying something that's a God level weight, and not someone else who's trying to put that God level weight on me, which I can't do, or anyone else, right? And you will be secure feasting on his faithfulness. You know, God is so faithful, it's a feast. Isn't that amazing? It is a feast that we get invited to. Do you know, he says to partake of the divine nature, his divine nature. We partake of his divine nature in us. We are divine because we're created by the divine in the image and likeness of the divine. Now, we are not God because we didn't create ourselves, and we don't have all cosmos authority, right? But we look just like him, right? So let's, you know, we've got to keep on going in the other ditch, okay? Okay. It says, make God the utmost delight and pleasure of your life. You know why that's doable? Because he is so delightful and pleasant. You see, tracking with God is an intoxicating adventure. Why? Because he is so lovely. He is breathtaking, and he is absolutely other giving. See, he came to serve, not to be served. And you know, in the place where he serves us, out of the overflow in being loved, we love one another and serve one another out of the overflow, not to get God to do squat. That's really insulting, right? If I've got to get God to do squat, that means I need to convince him. So which means his heart's not right, or, you know, I need to remind him that I still exist or something. But any of those things is really insulting to a God who is loved. Now, he's not insulted because he is lovely and untouchable and not easily offended. But this is the basis of our unbelief because we're seeing him wrong. And he will be the utmost delight and pleasure of your life. And he will provide what you desire most. Now, I want you to sit for just a little bit, because sometimes one thing that really will help us move forward where we're at and the places, our pain points right now, are meditating on where God has really, really come through. And sometimes for us personally, okay, chances are creating a 5-part sermon to preach to someone else is not going to minister to your own heart, right? But where you're meditating on where he's come through for you in the past, that stirs up your faith because you've been so well loved. And like, he showed up here, he showed up here, he showed up here, he showed up here. Look at what he did here. Wow, he pulled that one off. I had no idea he was going to do that. And let me say this, if you look for it, you will find it. You will find it. God, why? Because Holy Spirit will remind you of all those places where he's been, where you have a track record, a personal track record with him, right? And that will stir up faith to continue to keep trusting in the Lord and do what is right in his eyes, okay? All of that. Now, let me just remind you, just in case you forgot, you're not doing what is right in his eyes to get God to move, okay? Right? No. You're doing what is right because that's what you were made for. You were made to love, and love creates an open space that God can freely move. You know, and if you're acting like a jerk and a brat, well, I'm just saying God is not going to bless that. Why? Because he's conforming you into his image. And so he's not going to reward you for being brattish and entitled. Okay. But he will bless you just because he loves you. Good morning, Annie. How are you? Give God the right to direct your life. Now, this is kind of a big one. This is kind of where we get rebellious. Like, don't you tell me what to do. How many people are like that these days? In recently, I can't remember if this was, if it was take one or take two, where I was talking about how touchy people are. We've had some touchiness. I've been touchy. So if I get touchy, I go off in my own little corner and do some Jesus things, and sort of get filled up so I can come out lovely again, because I don't need to be part of the problem. But you know what? Where people are touchy, they're like, well, I'm not gonna let you do that. I'm not gonna let you do that, right? And so that's a big heart check, because it's a heart check with one, number one, we're seeing God wrong, like he's some sort of a bully or dictator, right? Or unlovely, or that honestly, or it's pride, where we think we can direct our lives better than God can, right? Jesus said, as you remain in me and me in you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. So humility says, apart from Jesus, I can do nothing. But as I remain in him, and I'm going to bear some big honking, eternal, ongoing, ever-growing, increasing, accelerating fruit. And that is you. So when you give God, you see, let me say this. One nice thing about this passage, you give God the right. You know, God is not a bully, right? He doesn't control people. So he's not going to force you and direct your life. Even if, you know, you're like, wow, I'm going to jump off a cliff. Well, just, you know, if that's what you want to do, God is not going to force you not to, okay? He's not going to force you not to hurt other people or hurt yourself. He's not going to force you. Okay, that is manipulation, control, which is witchcraft, which is not what God does. He's love, and love does not control. So when you give him, that means you yield. It's like, wow, you're amazing, you're lovely, you're smarter than me. So I'm going to relax and let you direct me and lead me, because you're smarter than me. Yeah, the sons of God and the daughters of God are led by the Spirit of God. And as we're led by the Spirit, what does it say? Oh, yeah, that brings freedom. Where the Spirit is Lord, there is freedom. How many of you need some more freedom? Ah, yes, we all vote for that, right? That means we're going to want to let God direct our lives, because he's a master conductor, right? And as you trust him along the way, that's by his grace, by the way, as you trust him along the way, you will find he pulled it off perfectly. And what are we talking about? The desires of your heart. The thing you desire most, right? The thing that's so near and dear. And sometimes we get so hung up on things that aren't the main thing. It's like, well, in order to be saved, I have to have this in order to stay saved. And it's like, oh, honey, let me just help you. You're being really immature right now. Let me minister to your heart and let me show you what you really need. And in that place where this is your heart's desire, that's what I'm going to fulfill. And that's why intimacy, guarding that intimacy, is so crucial. Is so crucial. Why? Because the half the time we don't even know what the heck we really need. We really don't, right? We really don't. But God knows. And he also knows, oh, it's so beautiful, the dreams and desires that he's planted in your heart. And it's his heart to fulfill those things. Yeah. Let's keep on going. Proverbs 13:12, it says, when hope's dream seems to drag on and on, you know, other translations, when hope is deferred, it makes the heart sick. How many of you can relate to that one? Yes, almost everybody can relate to that one. The delay can seem depressing. That means your heart is sick, right? But when at last your dream comes true, life's sweetness will satisfy your soul. When a desire is fulfilled, it is a tree of life in other translations. See, we forget that part. A, we get stuck in the depressing, hope deferred part, but we have to realize that as we're standing, it's like, oh no, God's going to make this thing work out. You know, a good mantra to tell yourself over and over, oh, let me just help you. Okay. One way or the other, it's going to turn out good. Yeah, this really sucks here, and I've got no idea how to make this okay or make this good. But one way or the other, it's going to turn out good. And you can say that and be can be absolutely solid in it because you're hooked up with a person who is love, right? That's leading and guiding you in the way you should go. One way or the other, it will turn out good. I don't know what's going to happen, but one way or the other, it's going to turn out good, right? Because God is good all the time, right? Let's talk a little bit. I thought I'd throw this in too, because this is cool. Let's talk about what God's heart's desire is. Okay. Well, number one, you're his heart's desire. He created you because he couldn't contain himself and he had to explode in love in your flavor on the planet realm. Okay. And with that, and John 17, 20 through 23, this is Jesus. He might know. And it says, and I ask, oh, this is Jesus talking to his father before he's going to go to the cross, right? It says, I ask not only for these disciples, but also for all those who will one day believe in me through their message. Raise your hand, say, that is me. Yes. It says, I pray for them all to be joined together as one. See, God's heart's desire is that we would be joined together as one, even, let me tell you the standard of oneness he's talking about. Even as you and I, Father, are joined together as one. Okay, so as much as Jesus is one with the Father, is one with Holy Spirit, that's how much God desires for all his kids to be joined together as one. I pray for them to become one with us. Now, let me say this. This is not something you're waiting to happen with. That happened on the cross. It actually happened before the foundation of the world when you were joined in Christ and chosen before the foundation of the world. And then God secured that for all humanity on the cross. So that was actually an answered prayer right there. So that the world will recognize that you sent me. Now, why is this important? Well, the world is the people that don't know Jesus yet, really. They know Jesus, but they don't know in a lot of ways. I think everybody knows, but you know, there's levels of knowing, right? There's levels of knowing that you may know a little bit because deep, deep inside you just know. But then there's knowing in a way that you're free. Knowing in a way that you're empowered, knowing in the way that you're healed, knowing in the way, right, that you're sozoed, saved, healed, delivered, right? It says, so that the world will recognize that you sent me. Sending Jesus was a big thing. Why? Because God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten son so that we might all live through him. So recognizing Jesus coming into the flesh is not a churchianity thing. It's not a religious thing. It is a humanity thing. One member of the Godhead became human for all time. Do you realize that one member of God values humanity so much he became one for eternity? It's so amazing. And puts you in himself so that you get to partake of his relationship with Father and Holy Spirit, right? And you're placed smack dab in that. So that they will be joined together as one and experience the same unity that we enjoy. This oneness with God, the enjoy the oneness that Jesus has with his Father, so we can have that oneness with our Father, and we can have oneness with one another. This is not a New Age concept. This is a Jesus concept that got hijacked by the New Age. Okay, so that they will experience perfect unity, and the world will be convinced that you have sent me, for they will see that you love each one. No one's excluded with the same passionate love that you have for me. So let me just ask you, how much, you don't have to say a word, but how much, ask yourself, how much am I tracking with Father God loves me as much as he loved Jesus, right? How much are you tracking? Well, let him minister that to you. That is God's desire, that we would know how utterly, completely adored we are, regardless of our performance. Regardless of if you've read the Bible, if you've ever read the Bible, if you fasted and prayed, if you picked out and not said a word, right? It's irrelevant, okay? because our behavior has no capacity to change how God feels about us. Now, how he feels about the behavior, that's a thing. Because if our behavior is hurting ourselves and hurting one another, well, you know what? Let's not do that. Okay? God loves us way too much to leave us to our own fallen devices where we don't know who we are, we don't know who he is, and we start to operate from that place, right? So God's desire is unity, experiential unity, that we would be experience. Hi, Andre, how are you, brother? I hope you're doing well. I'm so honored you joined. For those of you who haven't checked out Andre, do so. He's an amazing brother. Love him. He has amazing insight. So God's desire is for us to be one as he and the Father are one. That's the standard. Oh my goodness. So let me just say this. This is impossible. This is impossible. But guess what? Only God could pull it off. And guess how masterful he is. That we, he and the Father are one, him and us and him, that we would be together as one. And let me say, that's God's dream for humanity. And he is the one that has the capacity to do the impossible. And you know, we've been given one commandment. Oh my goodness, one. This is good because simplicity helps. How many of you need some simplicity? Because if it gets too complex, we get confused and disempowered, okay? I like to keep it really simple because simplicity brings power, empowerment. So we're called to love one another. See, that is our heart's desire. Isn't that your heart's desire? Oh my goodness, that we would love one another. Isn't that your heart's desire? That you and your kids would get along and love one another. You and your spouse would get along. You and your siblings would get along, right? You and your boss would get along. You know, everybody would get along because we were brother and sister before we ever got jacked up, right? We are brothers and sisters and are called to love one another to the standard that Christ loved us. And that is supernatural. And there's only one way we're going to get there from here. As we remain in him and us, we will bear much fruit. Apart from him, we can do nothing. See, when we get our eyes off of Jesus, okay, we get jacked up. And that is every single human being. That's a level playing ground. When we get our eyes off Jesus, we lose our way. The sons of God, the daughters of God are led by the Spirit of God. Well, what is God leading? He's leading us and guiding us into all truth. And he's leading us and guiding us to love one another. Really, and then, and you know what? This is how everything is fulfilled. This is how we actually become one human race in him, loving one another. And so when you're operating in that, you just can't help but love your brother and sister and do lovely things. And love's going to look different. Sometimes love is going to look warm and fuzzy. Sometimes love's going to look like some kick butt. Love's going to look different. Now, let me say, if you're wondering what love looks like, well, was Jesus on planet? It was sometimes Jesus would not break a broken reed, right? Would kneel down in the dust with the one caught in frank sin and say, I don't condemn you. Now go and sin. Don't operate in a fallen identity of who you are. Don't do that anymore. Let me empower you to do that because you are lovely and worthy of love. You don't need love, right? You've got the real deal. I'm right here. I'm right here. Accept no counterfeits, accept no substitutes, right? And sometimes he looked like that, and sometimes he looked like he is not happy with the Pharisees. It was always with the Pharisees, the one putting on loads, putting people in bondage, and doing it in the name of his Father, right? So woe to you, right? Woe to you, woe to you. Okay, that was not it's sometimes love looked like that. Did he love the Pharisees? Absolutely, absolutely. But sometimes, you know what? People are sowing the whirlwind. They're going to reap the whirlwind. We got to be careful. Okay. We got to be wise. And since Jesus is our wisdom and our sanctification and our empowerment in every sense of the word, it's going to look like Jesus. You know, sometimes he would go into, he went into the temple, they turned over the tables, all of that. Now, he wasn't using the whip to beat people. Okay, let's just driving out, you know, driving out all the implements that were turning his house of prayer into a den of thieves. Okay, so God is not a punisher. Okay, so it's not going to look like that. Sometimes it's helpful to ask, what does love not look like? Right? And you know, if you actually read, love is patient, love is kind, it doesn't, and then it's, that's the only two things that it is. And everything else until it gets to the very end of that verse is what it's not. We sometimes need that because we get confused. Right. But then it's a, and then it bookends it. It always trusts, always hopes, always protects, always perseveres. Love never fails. And that's what we're called to. That is the desire of your heart. It's going to look like love, but sometimes it's going to look like a baby. Maybe that's your heart's desire. Sometimes it's going to look like an opportunity to speak a message that is just, you're going to explode if it doesn't get out there. Been there. Sometimes love is going to look like being reconciled to a loved one. Sometimes love is going to look like, I have got to get my bills paid. Sometimes love is going to look like, I have a desire, I have extra, let me pay your bills. Sometimes love is going to look like a really hard conversation. Sometimes love is going to look like, I'm sorry. Sometimes love is going to look like, I'm going to sit with you in your pain. Sometimes love is going to look like allowing someone to sit with you in your pain. Love's going to look like a lot of things, but those desires is always going to look like love. That is your heart's desire because you were made in love by the person of love, to be loved. You are made of the substance of love himself. That's what the divine nature is. And so you get to partake of that. And as you release it, we transcend all the things that are keeping us in the hellish experiences that we are experiencing. It transcends it. It goes so far beyond it. You know, the one thing that I'm always amused with Jesus is when he was on the earth realm, the things that he would refuse to do. Because we're like, well, I can't be saved if you don't da-da-da-da-da, right? You know, we have our agendas. Anybody gone to God with their agenda and didn't like filter it through God first? Okay, that's all of us. And so sometimes God is like, not doing it. So Jesus, like, right? So there are things like sometimes Jesus, well, the big thing is that they're under this oppressive Roman society and they're, that's, it's like hell on wheels. And, you know, everybody's like, take over, right? Take over, come in your wrath, right? And Jesus, no, that's not my kingdom. Not doing that. We're not, we're going a different route. We're going to address it in a different way, right? When, you know, when the Samaritans, you know, were not responding to Christ and his message, and James and John, the sons of fire, right? The sons of thunder, sorry, saying, let's burn down, let's send down heaping coals in Samaria, you know, right? Let's like, you know, wrath. He's like, you do not know what spirit you're of. Not going to do it, not going to do it, right? Love doesn't look like that. And so that you said the beginning, middle, end of the day, we can, oh my goodness, let's go back to our verse that we started with because it was so good. We can keep trusting in the Lord. And sometimes we're like, I can't do it anymore. Well, apart from Christ, you can, for sure. But why can't you keep doing it? It's because you've disconnected with his faithfulness, right? And do what is right in his eyes. So this is not, remember we talked about, this is not, you know, I got to do this so I can convince God. I got to jump through the hoops to get him to move on my behalf, right? Okay, no. He jumped through hoops, by the way, so he could move on your behalf, just so you know. We can fix our heart on the promises of God and we will be secure feasting on his faithfulness. Listen, wherever your pain point is, oh, let me just be clear, okay? God has something to say about that. And you can feast on his faithfulness, but we've got to let go of the reins. We've got to let go of the reins and make God the utmost delight and pleasure of our life and let him provide. We've got to give God the right to direct our lives. And sometimes we get confused of what that looks like, right? And we start spinning off our own little agendas. And we've all done it. Level playing ground, no condemnation in Christ Jesus. Okay, we've all done it. I've done it, just to help you, lest you think. So I one thing I have learned is a holy distrust for my own agendas, right? Because they're things that we get jacked up with our own things. So I'm like, Jesus, yeah, so you just lead me. And see, the thing is, when we can start to relax, and the only reason you can relax is because God is so faithful. That's the only reason. Because God is so good. Because God still sees you in your pain. Because it matters to God. Listen, if it matters to you, it matters to God. Okay? And in the place where there are injustices, that's a human thing. And where it's happened, we can entrust ourselves to the Lord. There's something that we are called to do in response, absolutely, okay? But God gets to direct it. God gets to direct it. And so it's really important that we just keep our eyes fixed, because the moment we kind of start looking other places, we start to veer off. You know, if you want to keep on track with a coordinate, you fix your eyes on the end point. And guess who's the end point? Who's the telos? God is the telos. He's the Alpha and the Omega and every letter in between. You fix your eyes on, and that keeps you being guided by the one who loved you and gave himself up for you, the one that's able to take care of you and take care of your brother and sister, that's able to take care of your family, right? That's his, you know, he's a jealous God, but he's jealous for you. He wants to be the one to give you the desires of your heart, right? And sometimes we get so impatient that we're like, oh, forget this noise. I've been waiting for 20 years for a kid. I'm going off to get artificially inseminated or something. You know what I mean? And that usually ends in disaster, right? Now, he may lead you to do that. See, it's not an issue exactly of what to do. It's an issue of what God is leading you to do. And that's where cultivating that intimacy will be so life-giving, because he's the one who's longing to give you the desires of your heart. Yeah, he's longing. That's just who he is. He can't help himself. He's utterly smitten. See, he that spared not his only son, how shall he freely not with him give us all things? All things. Oh, baby, you get it all. You get it all because you're one with the person who is all in all. Absolutely. Anyway, okay. I guess we're done. I hope this has been a blessing. Okay, let me just do this real quick. So I will, I always have to work on this. It's so hard, it's backwards. Okay, I'm just going to promote this How to Hear from God thing. You can buy a physical copy on Amazon if you want for a couple bucks. But if you wait till I post this, there'll be a link for a free download, the whole book for you, because you're loved and fabulous, to help you connect with this, to help you connect with God in the area of your pain point and in the area of your longings and your desires, okay? And your ability to connect and just flow with intimacy, flow with his love, flow with his goodness, flow with his grace, all of that. You can light up like a Christmas tree every day of the year. Yay. So anyway, take advantage of that. It's totally free. If you click on the link, if you want the sexy hard copy, I got to charge it because it cost me. So and Amazon, last time I checked, is not doing them for free. So it'll be on Amazon for a couple bucks if you want that. And it's also on Kindle on Amazon. So that's a freebie for you if you download it. Let me hear from you. I love you guys. Thank you for doing the honor of joining me. I hope you guys have an amazing week. I'll be back on Wednesday, if not earlier. I love you guys. Have an amazing day. Bye-bye.